Okay. Show me.
Hi there, guys. Welcome back to the Dr. C channel. Thank you very much for tuning in for part 3 in my build series of a lightweight FPV quadcopter and a 5-inch at that. So in the last part, I reviewed this here frame, the Hyperlite Floss 3.0, version 3, basically. Right, and well, I'll have a link to that review up here for you if you're interested. This is a nice quadcopter frame, I think. It looks nice and it feels sturdy and it's light. So basically that makes the frame perfect for this build. I'm building a light 5-inch quadcopter. However, this frame is 74 grams more or less, including the camera mounts, these TPU camera mounts, and this antenna mount over here, I should add. So 74 grams, and is that light? That is light, I'd say. Anything below 100 grams is light. But 74 grams, there are lighter frames, as you probably know. And yeah, I kind of would have liked something lighter than this. So in this video, I'm gonna take a look at an alternative to this frame. And that alternative is in this here box. It is a box from Rotorama, as you can see, and it's called the Wasp. Now, in case you don't know Rotorama, this is a European company, so most European FPV pilots at least should know Rotorama. They specialize in racing frames. They actually even have a successful racing team. Look them up. They've been at it for quite a while. And this is also one of their best sellers at the moment. It is a 5-inch quadcopter and it is very, very light. Yeah, so it's a pretty unassuming box. Just like the Hyperlite Floss 3.0. And there you go. We have ourselves some quadcopter parts. As you can probably see, just like the Hyperlite Floss 3.0, it is a very simple frame, which makes it light. But, well, in this video, I'm going to review this frame and see if it's a viable alternative, if I'm going to continue this project with this frame or the Hyperlite Floss. So, what I'll do is I'll take everything out of the bag, I'll show you the components, and then I'm gonna build it. And then, well, I'm gonna measure things and tell you the dimensions and such, and not unimportantly, its weight. Yeah, so let's take everything out of the bags. Alrighty, here are the components for our Rotorama Wasp frame. Now, some of this frame is conventional and actually pretty similar to the Hyperlite Floss 3.0. However, there are some distinct differences. You have noticed that this quadcopter only has two arms. Well, it has four arms, of course, but these are boomerang arms. The front two arms you see over here, and these are the rear two arms. And besides that, you've got a bottom plate. Yeah, this is the bottom plate over here. And you've got a top plate. And that is also different than in the Floss. The Floss has a bottom plate and a brace and then the top plate. So it will be interesting to see if this frame is actually stiff without the top plate. I'm assuming it's not and it doesn't need to be, but should be interesting. And what you can also hopefully notice is that these boomerang arms aren't the same. The front arm is actually a 5-inch arm and the rear arm is a 6-inch arm. So this is a hybrid frame. And this is not the only hybrid frame. You are aware of hybrid frames. And this is a hybrid frame where the Floss, incidentally, is a non-hybrid frame, just so you know. So, yeah, you can easily see that the front arms are shorter than the rear arms. And okay, so you get a bag with an anti-skid pad for your battery and a few antenna mounts from the looks of it. Some camera mounts and standoffs and screws, of course. So actually, okay, so this frame does not come with a battery strap. That's, yeah. Okay, so the Floss 3.0 came with all these accessories, an antenna mount and a camera mount, and a strap, and a pad. Yeah, also with a pad. This one does not come with a strap, just so you know. That's the major difference in what you get for your money. And is this frame clean? I'm not sure if you'll be able to see that, but there is a little bit of dust on my finger. So I will be washing this frame. Yeah. There's not a huge amount of dust on the frame, definitely not. But I will be washing the frame parts. And the edges, I'm not sure, they aren't super sharp. So I assume they've done a little bit of sanding on them. But yeah, I'm not sure. I don't think you need to sand these, but I probably, you know, maybe I will. They have a light sanding on them already. And yeah, that's about it. That's the frame parts. What I'll do next is I'll build this quadcopter frame and then I'll come back to you. Okay, so there is our frame minus the top plate. And I'm actually happy to say that it is very stiff. Far more stiff than I had expected, really. And in case you wonder why I'm showing you the frame without the top plate and seeing if it's stiff enough, well, some people might prefer a TPU printed port instead of a top brace like so. Right, it'll protect your electronics and it might be more aerodynamic. So again, some people prefer a TPU printed port. And for that to be an option, you need to have a stiff frame without the top plate. So yeah, I guess it's good news for this frame that it's very stiff without the top plate. And yeah, it's perfectly flyable, I'd say, without the top plate. And I'm not sure if it'll save weight, this top plate, instead of a TPU print. A TPU print might actually weigh more, I'm not even sure. Oh well, again, it is an option with this frame. Okay, I'll build the rest of the frame and then I'll come back to you. Alright, hartstikke idee, we have ourselves a fully built WASP frame. Now, what should I tell you? Yeah, the build process is pretty straightforward. There are four screws in all, so the longest screws obviously go in from the bottom. And as you can tell, they go into lug nuts. Some frames, they only have standoffs, actually. Only standoffs. In this WASP frame, you screw your screws into these lug nuts and then you go and screw the uprights, the risers onto those. And that leaves you with two options, actually. You can build the frame as I build it here, but you could forgo these lug nuts and have the frame be lower. If your stack is lower, if you don't need that much room, you can opt to do that. So that's nice, I guess. Two options. And yeah, other than that, it's again very simple to build this frame. There's not much that can go wrong. What I should also tell you is that it accommodates 30 by 30 stacks and 20 by 20 stacks. And I will be using a 20 by 20 stack, so otherwise I wouldn't have selected this frame. Yeah, the edges, it does seem that these aren't sanded, or they are sanded ever so lightly. I would chamfer these edges myself, give them a light sanding. I've actually asked Rotorama about that, and they tell me that the chamfering of edges does come with a significant cost. I have no insight in that, but yeah, maybe you aren't interested in that. In that case, you won't be paying for it. And well, if you do want your edges to be sanded down, you'll have to do it yourself, just so you know. Now, for the measurements of this frame. Motor to motor at the front is 13.7 centimeters at the rear, 15.7 again, at the rear it's a wider frame, and front to back it's 16 centimeters, and wheelbase is exactly 22 centimeters. Yeah, okay. So if you'd want to build this frame as a 5-inch per se, so not a hybrid, you'd have to order it with two front arms, right? The front arm is 5-inch, the rear arm is 6-inch. So if you don't want a hybrid frame, you'll have to order up an extra front arm, and then you can build it as a normal conventional 5-inch. With that all said and done, we obviously want to know what this frame weighs. Okay, here we go. Again, I'm weighing this frame with antenna mount and camera mount, just like the Frost 3.0. Here we go. And okay, so it's not as light as I had expected, but we do save 10 grams more, basically. So again, this Floss 3.0, yeah, it has motors on it now, so it's significantly heavier, obviously. But this Floss 3.0 frame is 74-75 grams with included TPU antenna mount and camera mount. 64 grams for this Wasp with antenna mount and camera mounts. So yeah, that is definitely significantly lighter. Again, they probably weighed the frame without the camera mount and the antenna mount. I'm not even sure. But that's what the frame weighs. So what are my thoughts on this Wasp frame, and will I be using it for my lightweight build? First thing I should address is these arms, the boomerang arms. So this frame has four separate arms, like a lot of 5-inch quadcopters. This Wasp frame has, non-separable arms. If you break one arm, you are gonna be replacing two arms. And I'm sure that this is very stiff. It probably also saves some weight because you don't need a bracing thing to keep the two arms aligned. So yeah, I guess there are pros and cons to this, right? When I'm building a light quadcopter, I'd say that it's mostly pro. So a good thing to have these boomerang arms. And it might be a personal thing, or maybe if you are a racer and you often have to service your quadcopters in the field, four separate arms might be beneficial. I'm not even sure. I tend to not repair my quadcopters in the field most of the time. So, but it's very light, and these are 5 millimeter thick arms. The entire frame is super duper stiff. Very, very stiff, and that'll probably be beneficial for the flight performance of this frame. So yeah, besides me choosing between these two frames over here, I think this is a very nice frame, and it's a European product. For me as a European, that's a benefit of sorts, I guess. It's very light, and of course it's a hybrid frame, and I think it's debatable if that's a pro or a con. Theoretically, it's a pro, right? The rear propeller should have more clean and air to work with. So what I will do is, as you can see, I've already put the motors on the Floss 3.0 frame, but I will be transferring them to this frame. I want a light quadcopter, right? So 10 grams, I'll take that. Thank you very much. And to that, I have to add that I might eventually replace these motors with slightly smaller ones. But if you've seen my introduction of this series, these are the lightest 2207 motors I could find. Emax RS2207 motors. Oh well. Okay, so let me see what's next in this series. In the next episode in this series, I will be showing you the stack, the Diatone stack. There's a list of all the components I'll be using in this project in the description of this video. Check it out. And again, in the next video, I'll review the stack I'll be using in this frame. And that's it. I hope this was informative. If you are left with questions, hit me up or comment down below. Catch you on the next video. Bye-bye.